What I usually find at this point is everybody's so stunned. Go to the microphone. Okay, so some questions. Have we got any questions? We've got some. We've got a microphone over here. So let's start with a question over there. Yes.
How did you accidentally juggle 7 balls?
How did I accidentally juggle 7? When I was learning 5, I was serious about the way you learn 5 is you chuck them in the air and fail. And I was finding it was all way too fast. So what I did was I picked up 7 and had a go at starting 7. I knew I couldn't do it. There was no way I was going to be able to juggle 7. But I would start with 4 in this hand, 3 in this hand, and launch them as fast as I could to practice getting them in the air. And after practicing that for about 10 minutes, I was nearly exhausted. But then by putting down 2 of them, 5 felt so slow. Because I've been working much harder than necessary, and dropping back to 5 made it much easier. And one day, I actually had a perfect launch of 7. Just purely by accident, a perfect launch. And as they came down, I forgot to stop. And I kept going. And I got, on that occasion, I got 22 catches of 7 balls. Now, to get a world record, you need twice as many catches as you have balls, if they're all in order. So doing 7 balls, 14 catches, was enough to qualify as being able to juggle 7. I got to the point where I could do about 60 or 70 catches at 7, but it never interested me. I love the patterns. I love the math underneath it and why it works. But on that day, I accidentally juggled 7 balls. Question?
Oh, yes, my question. Do you remember when everyone in the crowd, you told us to pick a color of balls,
yep,
and each one that landed, which what was supposed to be your right hand,
mm-hmm,
you were supposed to say the color?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I picked orange, and instead of saying orange every time I touched the right hand, he accidentally said it for both right and left. So I kept saying orange, orange, orange.
Orange, orange,
and
orange.
I found that it just happened to land when everyone else said green. And it seemed to land on when everyone else said green or pink.
Yeah, what I heard, I actually heard you doing that. And it did, it's, well, you're in the front. You were very enthusiastic, and that's really cool. What happens is, when you're doing it on your own for the other hand, you tend to fall into the rhythm of other people that you hear. Have you ever noticed when you're walking with people, some of you just naturally tend to fall into step, and some of you don't? But what happens is most people tend to fall into a rhythm, and it's really hard. If you're trying to do the wrong hand, it's really hard to keep your own exact rhythm. And I heard you drifting backwards and forwards across the orange actually landing, because the orange lands here between the other two. So sometimes you drifted forward and sometimes you drifted back. And it looks like sometimes you're actually on the same one, but you can't really see both at the same time. So it's a good observation that that's what was happening. But there's a little bit more happening than maybe you noticed the whole time.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome. Yeah, good question. Yeah.
What do you do differently to juggle networks of ships?
Actually, when we're doing ships, we do, in fact, kind of treat berths and pinch points as hands and try to make sure they each only have one ship at a time. The art of juggling, as I have been doing here, is the art of throwing them up to different heights so that they come down one at a time. And it is, in fact, very similar, but we've got many, 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 many more hands and not as many ships. So it's actually more akin to bell ringing, the English style of bell ringing, where you've got lots of different things that you need to fit into, but you've got more places for them to go. But we can use very similar techniques to try to make sure we don't get things coming in at the same time. The analysis really does go through, as it does with packet flight across networks, if you want to avoid contention in communication over long distances. Yes?
Hi. I have a question. Does it work if you throw the balls down?
Yeah. The whole thing that I was doing here, it purely mattered what the flight time was from a hand to a catch, or indeed to the next throw. So all of this goes through for force bounce, lift bounce, force bounce with a drop on the end. All of it still works. You can also have multi-handed versions. So you can actually talk about juggling for the 8-handed juggler. And that sounds strange, but if you've got 4 jugglers together, you've got 8 hands. So all of this theory still does, in fact, work for the exceptionally gifted eight-handed juggler. You just need more of those vertical lines and somehow to avoid getting the confusion in between. Yes?
Well, when you juggle, it looks like when you're throwing it, it's very fluid and easy to throw it. And since most jugglers don't care about when you catch it, is it possible for you to juggle with your eyes closed?
There are a lot of people who can. And if you go to most juggling competitions, most juggling conventions, they will have a competition for blindfold juggling. And so everybody starts juggling three, the compere says, right, everybody close your eyes now. And immediately two-thirds of the people drop. So they open their eyes and they pick up their juggling balls and gradually work their way out. But there are people who not only can juggle with their eyes closed, but they can shift between Mills Mess, the shower, one over the top, and tennis, while with their eyes closed, for real. And they are absolutely phenomenal. And it is entirely down to knowing how it feels when you throw it and making sure the throw is perfect. Yeah, absolutely possible.
Thank you.
Welcome.
So after building all this theory all these years, have you ever come up with a way of representing Mills Mess?
Yes, we have a way of representing Mills Mess. It involves a diagram very similar to the one that I had with all of the big arrows on it. But now instead of each location representing the schedule of the balls about to land, each place represents either having your arms uncrossed or crossed left over right or crossed right over left, and the natural transitions between those. It's natural, if you're going to start with your arms uncrossed and finish with your left arm over the top, that you should throw on the outside, catch on the inside, and move over. And so there is a diagram that shows the transitions between those. It's called the MICS, or the State Transition Diagram for Mills Mess, the STD, or the MMSTD. A guy called Mike Day came up with it, and he is, in fact, still working on refinements of that. But now there are other notations where people talk about other places that you can throw and things that you can do. Beat map is another way of trying to describe all of this. But it loses the elegance, but it gains in expressivity. But it doesn't make any predictions. So this stuff makes predictions about what's possible. The other is merely describing what happens, rather than giving you a limited space to explore. Which can often be much more rewarding. But yes, we have.
This is not a question about anything that you said per se, but I thought the audience might be interested if there's anything you could tell us about any machines that have been built for juggling.
Oh, right. The first machine that was built to juggle, I believe, was by Claude Shannon, father of information theory. Used to be at Bell Labs, used to unicycle around Bell Labs, was a very competent juggler himself. And he built a machine which basically consisted of a couple of cups, and it would spill the ball, bounce on a drum and land in the other cup, and you could get three balls going like that. There are people now who have machines with sort of pistons in them, and so they have these pistons going back and forth. There are machines which have sort of robotic hands that juggle, but they all do fixed patterns. They're not very good at reacting to what the balls are doing. So if you actually nudge one of the balls in the middle of flight, it tends to go horribly wrong. It's very, very difficult to get machines to be fast enough, strong enough, and reactive enough. If they're doing a set pattern, you can make them as fast as you like. If they have to react, they tend to be a bit slower. And so the machines still can't juggle as adaptively as humans can. But certainly there are now machines that juggle seven balls, so long as they're on fixed tracks. And the research continues. People continue to find this an interesting challenge for the robotic systems they build. Last question.
What would be the longest time juggling if you had zero balls?
Oh, I've been able to do zero balls for the longest time. the world duration record for clubs that used to, when I looked it up, I mean, I don't keep track of these things, but there were people who juggled three clubs for 8 hours and 40 minutes. The problem with doing that is your vision system ends up editing out the pattern. You can't actually see the club, so you do need to go back to effectively juggling blindfold. But zero balls is quite energetic. But you can do zero balls for a very, very long time. I have succeeded myself. I don't think anybody else has actually set the record for that, so maybe I should claim that for myself. I think that's a great question to finish with. Thank you.